Good morning.
Good morning.
Hello and welcome to Neighborhood Unitarian Universalist Church in Pasadena. Welcome to all members, friends, and guests here in person and virtually. My name is Mae Colcord and I am a member of your Board of Trustees. Neighborhood Church creates and grows an inclusive community of faith connected by love, spirit, and service. We acknowledge our presence on the ancestral and unceded territory of the Gabrielino Tongva peoples, the traditional caretakers of the lands and waters of this campus. With respect for the rights and wisdom of Indigenous people, we acknowledge our harmful colonial histories and commit to decolonizing our own practices, to learning new ways of being in community and with each other, in good relationship with the Indigenous people of this land and with the land itself. Today's service is led by guest minister Reverend Liz Murphy, with music led by music director Dr. Zenaida Robles, associate music director Wells Lang, and the wonderful Neighborhood Choir. Please take a moment to silence your devices as we begin our service. Thank you for joining us as we continue to prioritize connection over perfection in this hybrid service, which is streamed and recorded on YouTube. Families with young children are welcome in both the sanctuary or the narthex. Mark your calendars. Next Sunday, April 28th, at the 11:30 service, we will be recognizing those who have chosen to become official members of Neighborhood Church this year. If you consider yourself a new member but have not heard from membership manager Ginger Fury, you may be missing a step to formally joining, so please reach out. Our order of service and more extensive announcements are available as a link in the Sunday email, posted in the narthex, or through the QR code on the back of your hymnal. You can always get more information on these and many other activities at the welcome table. Again, welcome to Neighborhood Church, whoever you are and wherever you are in your spiritual journey. Welcome to this inclusive faith community connected by love, spirit, and service.
Good morning. Good morning. Great to be with you all. Great to see all the green for Earth Day Sunday. I said in the earlier service, I don't have any like more formal green, so I wore my poppy stole. Hopefully that will count. But it's great to be with you all. Thank you for the warm welcome. I'm happy to return to your wonderful congregation this morning. And for those of you I haven't yet met, my name is Reverend Liz Murphy. I'm a UU minister based just down the road in Monrovia, and I currently work as a staff chaplain at the VA hospital in Loma Linda. I'm also the affiliated community minister at Orange Coast UU in Costa Mesa. So just all over the place in Southern California. But it's always such a joy to return to UU worship and community on Sunday mornings. And today in worship, on this beautiful Earth Day Sunday, we will be turning to one of life's greatest teachers, nature. How might Hildegard of Bingen's spiritual teaching of Viriditas reignite all that is blossoming in our lives right now? How might the creative, greening power of truth spur us toward new ways of understanding ourselves and one another? This Sunday, we will explore Viriditas together. And so as we consider these questions, I want to share these words to center us in our space by the Reverend Julian Soto. All that we are, together and individually, is part of the abundance of the universe. We are made of stars. We are made of earth. All that we have comes from the earth, from the labor of those in our communities, from the cities, the farms, and the oceans that enliven us, the world and those who live in it. We are surrounded by blessing, by grace, and by possibilities. We are reflected in every other human being. We respect and honor one another's differences, and we celebrate our interbeing with abundance in the practice of generosity. And so as we cross this threshold into service, into this sacred space we create together, I turn to our chalice lighting words, to light our beautiful chalice, the symbol of our faith. These words come from the Reverend Paul Sprecher. We light this chalice for the web of life which sustains us, for the sacred circle of life in which we have our being, for the earth, the sky, above and below, and for our Mother Earth, and for the grand mystery. Come, let us worship together.
Please rise in body or in spirit and join us in singing our opening hymn, number 1067, Mother Earth, Beloved Garden.
Thank you. Good morning.
I am Matt Basco, Neighborhood's Director of Spiritual Exploration, and it's a pleasure to be with you all this morning. Could we have all of the children and youth please come forward for a story for all ages? I just wanted to comment and say how fortunate we are to have Reverend Liz back with us this morning. I've known Liz since about 2018, and those of you with a strong institutional memory may remember that Liz served on staff here for about 6 to 8 months when she was going through seminary. So welcome back, Liz. Our book today, it has to do with a very special holiday, special to me, I think special to everyone here, special holiday happening tomorrow. Can any of you tell me what that holiday is? Earth Day. Our book today is called Earth Day Every Day. It's by Lisa Bullard and has pictures by Zhao Xin, yes. A Z sounding name spelled with an X. Interesting, huh? Earth Day Every Day. People don't always take good care of our earth home. Oh no. We do things that hurt the earth, maybe even unintentionally. We make the air dirty. We throw away too much paper and waste. We waste power. Mom says people should clean up their own messes. Yes. Earthlings made this earth mess, so we earthlings should fix it. It's a job for everyone. Yeah. We can fix it. My teacher taught my class how to plant trees. Everyone got to help. Someday our trees will grow to be much taller than we are. They'll make good homes for birds. And this says, you can also plant special gardens to feed bees and butterflies. We sometimes call those pollinator gardens. And trees and plants aren't just helpful to animals, they also clean the air we all breathe. Yes. My friends formed an Earth Day Club. We had our first meeting at lunch. Earth's problems mean problems for animals, too. Even my favorite, tigers, are having trouble. So our club decided to save money to help animals. They've got drawings of tigers and a hippo and a panda. They've got a cool flag that says Earth Day Club. People have formed many groups to help animals in trouble. The groups find ways to protect animals and the places they live. They study the animals to figure out new ways to help them. You can learn more about these groups on the internet. Just ask a teacher or parent to help you use this tool. My family and neighbors had an Earth Day trade. Everybody brought stuff they don't need anymore. And this box says, it's better for the earth when we reuse old things, right? Reduce, reuse, recycle. Reuse means to use something again. Then it doesn't end up in the trash. You also don't need to buy new things. trading, and reusing helps the earth. We traded for things we want. Mom wouldn't let me trade my brother. So I traded an old puzzle for a soccer ball. Sounds like a good deal. Now my family is having a special Earth night. We turned off the TV and the computer. That way, we don't use as much power. Instead, we're playing board games. My dog Daisy and I are winning. Using power can make the air dirty because of coal-powered power plants, right? Yeah. So turn off lights and machines whenever you can. Play outside instead of playing video games. Saving power helps save the earth. Yeah, maybe someday this page will be obsolete because we'll have all solar and wind power, right? Yeah. Maybe you can use your mouth to do great things. Together, we can talk to everyone about helping the earth. We'll ask people to make it Earth Day every day, when we can all find other ways to save planet Earth together, each and every day, and make every day Earth Day. Right? Yeah! Woo! Thanks, everybody. Let's sing our children and youth out to their spiritual exploration classes.
Sunday, our congregation dedicates 100% of its contributions to 501c3 organizations or neighborhood church-based social justice activities that are making a difference in our community and the world. Each selected guest organization aligns with our community's mission and values and is nominated by church members who often are longtime volunteers and supporters of these change-making organizations. In addition to placing your donation in the plate, online giving is available using the QR code on the donations box just outside the sanctuary or using the text instructions shown on the screen. If you wish to make a payment toward your pledge or contribute to church operations, make a note in the subject line or use an envelope available at the donation box. This week, our gifts will support Neighborhood's sponsorship fee for the first ever National UU Climate Revival this fall in honor of Earth Day. To learn more, please direct your attention to the screens above.
We at Neighborhood Church, me professionally and you as leaders in this congregation and in this region, we have a legacy of working towards climate justice. I'm proud to say that I have been part of a nationwide group of religious educators and ministers and congregants planning a national Unitarian Universalist climate revival coming up this fall in September on the 28th and 29th. This revival will focus on intersectional climate justice over the period of 2 days and will include nationwide programming and worship and celebration. We will do this synchronously and asynchronously. We'll be doing it together with other UUs coast to coast. It will be a grand commitment to reimagining our way towards and celebrating a renewed focus on climate justice. Neighborhood UU Church is a sponsor of this event, and 100% of today's Share the Plate will go to that sponsorship. We are one of a handful of UU congregations that are financially supporting this amazing work at a national level. And I thank you for your generosity. We'll be talking more in the coming months about how we as a congregation will organize this event here on our campus so that we can be a regional hub for other UU congregations in the area. In the meantime, if you'd like to know more about it, please visit uuclimatejustice.org. And thank you for your generosity.
Would the volunteers please come forward? We thank you in advance for giving generously.
Today's anthem, Baba Yetu, is the Swahili version of the Lord's Prayer or the Our Father.
beautiful. So I have an anthem that is a sort of prayer. It is a prayer. And our reading this morning, too, is a sort of prayer. It comes from Hildegard of Bingen, the source of inspiration for our service today. As we'll learn a little bit later in the service, Hildegard was a 12th century Benedictine nun, author, mystic, and musician. This poem of hers is called Viriditas, which is her concept that combines the Latin words of green and truth. I think this work beautifully affirms our interconnectedness with the earth, as well as joyfully proclaims our place here on the planet. She writes, "I am the one whose praise echoes on high. I adorn all the earth. I am the breeze that nurtures all things green. I encourage blossoms to flourish with ripening fruits. I am led by the Spirit to feed the purest streams. I am the rain coming from the dew that causes the grasses to laugh with the joy of life. I call forth tears. I am the yearning for good. May it be so."
Thank you.
Thank you for that beautiful performance. And it feels as a sort of a meditative space as we move into our sermon. So I invite you just to maybe close your eyes for a moment or let your gaze go soft. Face down at the floor. Let the hauntingly beautiful music we just heard flow over your spirit, over your body and your energy. And taking some deep cleansing breaths, breathing in and out. And another in through the mouth, in through the nose, and out through your mouth. And one more, breathing in and out. May it be so, and amen. It's such a joy to hear some of Hildegard's music this morning, coming to life. Some 12th century jams coming straight to you from our wonderful musicians. And as we mark this special Earth Day Sunday, I wanted to be intentional about reconnecting with our planet by taking a walk through the park near my house this morning. Maybe some of you have an Earth Day ritual that you like to do as well. This morning I took a moment to breathe in the smells of the flowers, to watch the tree branches sway in the wind, to take note of the many little flying things zipping in and around it all. It's amazing to see all of the things that have grown taller and wider, that have gotten pruned back, that have been planted anew. The many colors of the rainbow were represented along that path that I walked. There are tall bushes and trees, short, squat flowers. The bees were buzzing, and the butterflies were pollinating. And of course, across the many compost heaps around our communities, it's all breaking down. The cycle of life beginning again from all that has wilted and died. From death comes life, and on it goes. You see, sometimes I need to slow down to really appreciate the majesty of nature. It so often informs our understanding of spirituality and community. It's a source of inspiration and hope. And that park is most certainly alive. It's a kinetic, creative place that requires many hands to keep it thriving and verdant. A sort of viriditas exists in the garden just outside these walls, and I'm sure at home and in your communities. That word, viriditas, is a Latin term coined by Hildegard of Bingen. As we talked about earlier, it's this combination of the words green and truth, and it speaks to the creative power of life. And as Hildegard wrote, viriditas is an essential feature of the sacred, as well as something each one of us has inherently within us. The greening power of life is in us and around us always. And I know what you might be thinking. Can we actually learn something relevant from a 12th century Benedictine abbess from Germany? I hear it. I hear what you're saying. But I think the answer is yes. I think her theology, her writing, her music all speak into our understanding of life and beyond as Unitarian Universalists. And on this Earth Day Sunday celebration, Hildegard reminds us of our interconnectedness to everything around us. It's a beautiful illustration and echo of our seventh UU principle, that principle which states our respect for the interdependent web of all existence, of which each one of us are a part. You see, Hildegard found God and great inspiration in the natural world around her. She also leaned into the complexities of life, with viriditas being a beautifully layered concept. As we read earlier, I am the one whose praise echoes on high. I adorn all the earth. I am the breeze that nurtures all things green. I encourage blossoms to flourish with ripening fruits. I am led by the Spirit to feed the purest streams. I am the rain, coming from the dew that causes the grasses to laugh with the joy of life. I call forth tears. I am the yearning for good. Those words are a sort of definition of viriditas. It's a grand affirmation and proclamation, a statement of identity and purpose. And it's full of joy, full of love, full of promise. I think there is something for us to learn here, something prescient for the time and age we are in now. How might we embody the yearning for good? How might we adorn all of the earth? Church, as we ponder these questions, I think it's important for us to understand who the person of Hildegard was in her time. How did this woman, living in quiet and closed community nearly 900 years ago, become someone whose life and work continues to have echoes in our world today? And for those of you who are not music or art history or Catholic grade school graduates, I will share a little bit of her background. She was born in 1098 in West Franconia, which we now know as Germany. Today, we would see she was born close to the Belgian border on that western portion of the country of Germany. She was the 10th child born into a wealthy family, but she faced adversity from a young age. She dealt with chronic illness that was debilitating and disruptive for her. Scholars now believe she may have had severe migraines, which were not understood really at all at that time. So, at age 8, her parents sent her away to a Benedictine monastery that had just recently added a section for women. She lived under the care of a female resident there, and Hildegard's parents said she was now the family's, quote, tithe to God. Just a little pressure, right? And so in time, the convent grew, and more women joined their ranks. And I think it's important for us to note that convents at this time were perhaps one of the only places in Western society where women were able to learn to read, write, study, and grow their intellect and interests. Without the pressures of raising and rearing children, women in the convent had the opportunity to instead focus their interests elsewhere. Hildegard took this opportunity and she ran with it. She was a voracious reader, pouring into philosophy and science. And it didn't stop there. Hildegard loved music and composition. Her work, Ordo Virtutum, is a play set to music. While it's not exactly what we would call an opera today, many scholars believe that without this piece, we may not have the field of opera as we know it. Her work planted the seed for this entire field of musical creativity and creation. Her creativity, her intellect, and her leadership primed her to take on the role of head of the convent in 1136 at age 38. And so as she took the helm, she made another radical move. She convinced the church leadership to allow the women to move their convent about 18 miles away, out of the shadow of the men's monastery. This gave Hildegard and the women of the convent considerable freedom during a time when that was almost unheard of. And as you might expect, she gained some enemies within the hierarchy of the church. She was accomplished in so many fields, a polymath by many accounts, and did not back down from her belief in what was right. And of course, she was a woman. In one major flashpoint, she approved the burial of a man who had been excommunicated by the church, by her account, for political reasons. Hildegard ensured that he had last rites and was able to be laid to rest at her convent. She told the male church authority that God was on her side, that their politics did not supersede the human need for a proper burial and memorial for this person. When the church authorities discovered she had defied them and allowed the man to be buried there, they excommunicated the entire convent and, perhaps even more painful, barred them from singing. And of course, the authorities also demanded that the body be exhumed. But Hildegard dug her heels in. She refused. She refused the exhumation and instead appealed to a higher church authority. Eventually, as the dust settled, the excommunication and the rule against singing was lifted, and the man was not exhumed. So talk about a life, right? Hildegard was unabashed about her beliefs and maintained an integral connection to her understanding of God and the divine. And of course, she wasn't perfect. She is just like the rest of us. She still held many beliefs about the role of women and the authority of the church that would fly in the face of our understandings today. But her commitment to something beyond the trappings of human institution and the rules of the day remain an inspiration. Her work continues to influence and empower. And her concept of viriditas continues to hold an essential truth that can still inspire today. Because of her view of an intrinsic connection with nature around her, she became an expert in holistic medicine. Understanding that just as humans can nurture and heal the earth can nurture and heal humanity. She wrote in another poem, "I blaze above the beauty of the fields. I shine in the waters. I burn in the sun and the moon and the stars. And with the airy wind, I quicken all things to life, as with an invisible life that sustains them all. For the air lives in Viriditas and in the flowers, and the waters flow as if alive. And the sun lives within its own light, and when the moon has waned, it is rekindled by the light of the sun and thereby lives anew. And the stars shine forth in their own light as though alive." She understood the basic truth that there is more to a blade of grass than just its small stature and green color. There is a sacred aliveness in that blade of grass, and its existence is integral to the balance of life all around it. It is just essential to the fabric of life as she is as a human being. Hildegard was telling us that the cure for what ails us as a society is all around us. We just have to pay attention. I think tending to all that is around us teaches us an exceptionally simple but important lesson. We all need tenderness, time, and care, just like the flowers in the garden. We all live through times of verdancy and times of fallowness. We all have times of pruning and times of growth. We all have times of independence and times of cooperation and solidarity. And at the time of death, our being makes way for more life. Couldn't our world use a little more Viriditas right now? Its wisdom is simple and true. The greening power of life surrounds all of us and is within all of us. So, church, this morning I ask each of you, to what and to whom do you want to channel your creative greening power? What areas of your life need some pruning? What do you need to offer more water and sunshine to within yourself, within your communities? How can our connection to the sacred empower and embolden this work? I pray that as alive, kinetic, and creative your favorite gardens are, we can embody that in ourselves and in the world around us. May we be the people who adorn all of the earth, who feed the purest streams, who call forth tears, and are the very yearning for good. May it be so, blessed be, and amen.
Our closing hymn is number 163 in our gray hymnal, "For the Earth Forever Turning, Please Rise in Body or in Spirit."
We are joyful song of peace.
As we move into our benediction, I wanted to first extend my incredible gratitude to the staff and volunteers and beautiful musicians and choir who made today's service happen and so wonderfully. Thank you. And of course, thank you to all of you for welcoming me back into your wonderful space, those here in the sanctuary and those tuning in from home. I'm so glad to have spent my Sunday morning with you all. And so for our closing prayer, who else will we hear from but Hildegard? Good people, most royal, greening verdancy, rooted in the sun, you shine with radiant light in this circle of earthly existence. You shine so finely, it surpasses understanding. You are encircled by the arms of the mystery of the Spirit. May you go in peace. Blessed be and amen.
Of trees, the cherry now is hung with bloom along the bough and stands about the woodland right, wearing white for Eastertide. From 70 springs a score, it only leaves me 50 more. And since to look at things in bloom, 50 springs a little room. About the woodland I will go to see the child.